Good evening, everyone. Today I'll be presenting on RPE dystrophies. I'll be covering the topic in the following subheadings: introduction, classification, followed by a detailed description of Behr's disease, Stargardt's disease, pattern dystrophy, and other dystrophies. RPE is a monolayer of pigmented epithelium cell which is located between the neural retina and the vascular choroid. It generally remains stationary and do not proliferate. It performs vital functions like phagocytosis secretion, maintenance of blood-retinal barrier, and helps in transportation. Adding a note on lipofuscin, it is an intralysosomal complex of proteins, carbohydrates, and metals, the major source of which is photoreceptor outer segment, and the amount is linearly related to age. It increases with age. The major component of lipofuscin is A2E, which is formed as a byproduct of the visual cycle. It is toxic as it makes the cell susceptible to oxidative damage. Clinically, the classification of retinal dystrophies is confusing because of both clinical and genetic heterogeneity. There are several ways in which we can classify them: as progressive, stationary, central or generalized, and on anatomical basis, those affecting the photoreceptor cells, RPE cells, and Bruch's membrane or choroid. Moving on to Best vitelliform macular dystrophy, it was first described by Dr. Frederick Best in 1905. It is a clinically heterogeneous disease showing autosomal dominant mode of inheritance. Moving on to genetics, it is caused by mutation in BEST1 gene, which encodes for a protein bestrophin, which is located on the basolateral part of the RPE cells and which activates the calcium activated chloride channels. There are more than 100 mutations noted, the most common being a missense mutation. Another gene implicated as a cause is the IMPG1 gene, which encodes for a protein which is known as PAS protein, a component of the photoreceptor extracellular matrix domain, thus concluding that the impairment of interphotoreceptor matrix might be one of the cause for Best disease. Generally, the presentation is before puberty. The patient presents with decrease in the central vision and they are hyperopes with narrow angles. Why progressive stages are there based on the fundus examination? These stages do not occur consecutively, nor do they occur in all the patients. In pre-vitelliform stage, the patient is generally asymptomatic with normal fundus or subtle RPE alterations. In vitelliform stage, the patient presents with mild visual impairment. On fundus examination, there is a well-circumscribed yellowish elevated lesion resembling that of the egg yolk. The size of this lesion is inversely proportional to the age of presentation. This patient generally have a normal visual acuity, the reason being the vitelliform lesion has an ionic composition which is relatively similar to that of normal interphotoreceptor matrix. In pseudohypopyon stage, the yellow material gravitates inferiorly and accumulates inferiorly, forming a horizontal demarcation line. In vitelloeruptive stage, there is partial resorption of this material, giving rise to a scrambled egg appearance. After a dynamic alternating processes of material accumulation and resorption, it ultimately leads to formation of an atrophic or a fibrotic lesion. So why is there a vitelliform lesion develops in Best disease? The reasons could be because of altered kinetics of phagocytosis or due to changes in the acidification or the delivery of the lysosomal enzymes. And why is the macula affected? This could be because of differences in the bestrophin-1 expression in the different regions of retina or because of differences in the addition of the photoreceptors to the RPE cells. There are also variations, like it can present as a multifocal disease or a unilateral disease. Moving on to investigations, on fundus autofluorescence in vitelliform stage, there is intensely increased autofluorescence seen. In vitelloeruptive stage, there is granular increased pattern of fluorescence seen at the periphery and inferiorly, whereas in case of atrophic and fibrosic stages, there is decreased autofluorescence due to atrophy and by the formation of the scar. On fluorescent angiography, there is block fluorescence seen in the vitelliform stage. Hyperfluorescence can be seen because of transmission defects, because of leakage when there is development of CNVM, or because of staining because of the fibrotic scar. Moving on to OCT findings, in pre-vitelliform stage, there is thickening of the interdigitation layer, which is also known as Verhoff's layer. In vitelliform stage, there is hyperreflective dome-shaped lesion, which is seen between the ellipsoidal cells and the RPE cells. In pseudohypophyon stage, there is an optically empty space seen with clumping of hyperreflective material, and in vitelloeruptive stage, there is disintegration of this material and the surrounding structures, followed by atrophic stage. An observational study on OCTA features of Best disease was done. The result showed that OCTA was superior to fluorescein angiography in measuring the CNVM, and they also defined a new pattern of CNVM in Best disease, that is a ring-shaped pattern, others being loose net, dense net, and an unidentifiable pattern. On EOG, the Arden's ratio is generally found to be less than 1.5. The probable mechanism of which is when normal light falls, it causes an increase in the light-activated substance, which binds to the apical membrane of the RPE, which causes the activation of a second messenger, which is probably the calcium, causing increased conductance of chloride channel and depolarization, resulting in light peak. So in Best disease, this chloride channel is blocked. On ERG, the scotopic and photopic responses are generally normal. The closest disease which is confused with Best disease is that of adult onset fovea vitelliform dystrophy. It is a most common type of pattern dystrophy. The differences between the two is that it has a later age of onset, slower progression, and the lesions are generally small in size with central pigment clumps with normal Arden's ratio. They generally present with mild visual impairment, and the stages parallel that of Best disease with normal EOG findings. This is a 50-year-old male who presented with a moderate visual impairment. On fundus examination in both eyes, there were subfoveal yellowish vitelliform lesions, which were hyperautofluorescent, and on OCT, there were subfoveal dome-shaped hyperreflective deposits with normal EOG, suggestive of adult-onset fovea vitelliform degeneration. Recently, a late-onset complication known as RPE aperture on OCT was reported in the vitelliform stages, which represent an ongoing process in the natural course of a disease. It differs from RPE rip in the form that there is no retraction seen at the edges. The mechanism of the nature of this is yet to be studied. This is a series of OCT from a patient. In the first OCT, you can see an optically empty space. In the second, there is a formation of a RPE aperture, which increases on the follow-up. Even a modest trauma can lead to subfoveal bleed, so the patient should be prescribed protective glasses. CNVM can develop in any stage, and they should be treated with VEGFs. The prognosis is good, and progression of vision loss is very slow. BEST1 gene mutation is also associated with other diseases known as bestrophinopathies. Autosomal recessive bestrophinopathy was first described by Burgess et al. It generally presents in second decade of life. Patient presents with progressive loss of vision. They are generally hyperopes with shallow angles, and on fundus examination, they can have solitary or multifocal lesions, sometimes associated with flecks. A 26-year-old lady presented with moderate visual impairment. On fundus examination, she showed multiple yellow subretinal deposits and foveal thinning was present with RPE alterations. Fundus autofluorescence, there were multiple hyperautofluorescent deposits. And on OCT, there was foveal thinning with inner layer schisis was present. ERG was normal, and EOG, there was reduced Arden's ratio. So diagnosis of autosomal recessive bestrophinopathy was made. Another bestrophinopathy is autosomal dominant vitreoretinochoroidopathy. It is an autosomal dominant disease in which there are anterior segment developmental abnormalities, which includes microcornea hyperopia. The vitreous can be normal or fibrillar, and on fundus examination, there is a well-circumscribed pigmented peripheral retinal degeneration starting from ora serrata to the equator. The EOG is subnormal, and full-field ERG can be normal with variable reduction. Moving on to next pattern dystrophy, it is a group of autosomal dominant disease which is characterized by deposition of either yellow, orange, or gray pigments in the macular region. It is caused by mutation in periferin gene, the product of which helps in the development and maintenance of photoreceptor outer segments. They are classified according to the pattern of pigment distribution on autosomal dominant adult onset fovea vitelliform degeneration as discussed above, Butterfly shape, as the name implies, is characterized by deposition of pigments resembling the wing of butterfly. In reticula, there is symmetrical and reticular pattern of accumulated pigments starting from fovea to the periphery, followed by multifocal, in which there are multiple irregular pigment deposits seen throughout the fundus, and a rare, which is known as fundus pulverulentis, which is characterized by coarse pigmentation of the RPE seen in the foveal region. In-house case report on the fundus pulverulentis, in which a 35-year-old lady presented with gradual loss of vision in the both eyes. The fundus examination of both eyes, there were coarse pigmented granules seen in the macular region. A composite multicolor fundus imaging was done, in which a greenish hue was seen at the macula, and orange hyperpigmented spots, which were suggestive of alterations in the RPE pigment, was seen. On fundus autofluorescence, there were hyporeflective lesions, and on fundus angiography, there was block fluorescence seen. In near-infrared reflectance, there were multiple white hyperreflective spots seen over the posterior pole, and the blue and the green reflectance images show no abnormalities. So what is multicolor fundus photo? It is based on the confocal scanning laser imaging technology, in which it uses three laser wavelengths, the blue, green, and the infrared, simultaneously. It diagnoses the images so that distant structures can be seen at different depths. Moving on to Stargardt's disease, it was first described by German ophthalmologist Dr. Karl Stargardt in 1909. It is the most common inherited retinal dystrophy with a prevalence of 1 in 10,000, having autosomal recessive mode of inheritance. It is caused by a mutation in ABCA4 gene on chromosome 1, which encodes for a membrane protein, which is responsible for clearing the retinoid intermediates from the visual cycle, as shown in this figure. So the mutation results in formation of A2E, which is shed in the RPE lysosomes, resulting in subsequent RPE atrophy followed by photoreceptor cell death. Generally, the patient presents with bilateral loss of central vision, and the visual acuity depends on the age of onset. The earlier the onset, they will have severe visual impairment and poor prognosis as compared to a later age of onset. In the era of confusion between Stargardt's disease and fundus flavimaculatus as the same disease entity or different, Fishman et al. Gave a clinical classification of Stargardt's disease into four progressive stages. In stage one, there are pigmentary changes noted at the macula or associated with a metallic sheen and a pisciform ring of flakes within first 1 disc diameter from the center of fovea. In stage two, this pisciform flakes often extended beyond the arcades and nasal to the optic disc. In stage 3, there were diffusely resolved flakes associated with RPE atrophy at the macula. And in stage 4, diffusely resolved flakes were present and RPE atrophy was present throughout the entire fundus. On FFA, the hallmark is a silent choroid due to the block fluorescence resulting from lipofusion deposition. The retinal vessels stand out in sharp contrast to the dark background, but FFA is not a preferred investigation because exposure of light is a known cofactor in the disease progression, and it is an invasive test. So autofluorescence is a preferred investigation. Fushinami et al. Gave a classification based on the fundus autofluorescent findings seen in Stargardt's disease patient. Accordingly, type 1, there is a localized low autofluorescent signal seen at the fovea, surrounded by a homogeneous background. In type 2, there was localized low autofluorescent signal at the macula, surrounded by a heterogeneous background. And in type 3, there were multiple areas of low autofluorescent signal at the posterior pole and a heterogeneous background. So what they found was type 1 had the slowest rate of progression than type 2 and type 3. So this could help us to prognosticate the patient for the visual acuity and for enrolling the patients in clinical trial. Since light is found to be a cofactor in the disease process, to reduce light exposure, there have been several studies on low on reduced illumination autofluorescence and near infrared autofluorescence. The area of reduced near infrared autofluorescence is generally larger as compared to the fundus autofluorescent alteration. The reason could be because of the basal displacement of melanin in the diseased RPE cells, resulting in reduced near infrared autofluorescence. On OCT, there is thinning seen in the fovea with loss of the outer retinal layers. In children, before any structural and functional changes can occur, the earliest finding noted is a thickening of the external limiting membrane, which reflects a gliotic response to the cellular stress at photoreceptor level. A prospective observational case series on 16 patients with Stargardt disease was done using ST-OCT, in which they found two types of flecks. Type 1 was located at the level of RPE, and type 2 was located at the level of outer nuclear layer. This study showed that type 2 deposits were more associated with photoreceptor loss and progressive foveal atrophy as compared to type 1. Our in-house publication on SSOCT features of Stargardt disease was done. In 52 eyes were evaluated using SSOCT. The choroidal thickness was measured using a ETDRS grid pattern and also using an automated software. The results found were there was thinning in the superficial choroidal vessels and there was compensatory dilatation of the large choroidal vessels. A similar study on OCTA has also shown reduction in the choriocapillaries as compared to healthy eyes, but this was found in advanced cases. ERG in Stargardt disease is variable. ERG at baseline has a prognostic implication. Lois et al. Gave a ERG-based classification of Stargardt disease in which they divided them into three groups. Group 1 has abnormal pattern ERG findings with normal fulfilled ERG findings. Group B, the pattern ERG was abnormal associated with cone ERG abnormalities. And in group 3, the pattern ERG was abnormal associated with cone and rod dystrophies. These ERG findings did not depend on the age of onset, duration of disease, and the clinical fundus presentation, concluding that these three types could represent three different phenotypes of the disease. Role of MF-ERG. The MF-ERG can be useful in diagnosing early stages, differentiating from other disease in case of confusion, and to map the cone activity loss more precisely. No systemic association is known to occur with Stargardt disease, but there is one case report of two siblings with carpus callosum abnormality associated with mental retardation and Stargardt disease. The patient should be instructed to avoid sun exposure and vitamin A supplements. Various treatment options have been tried. First is the pharmacological agents, which modulate the visual cycle, have been investigated, which include fenretidine, ACU-4429, ALK-001. Even eye drops have been tried, that is NS2 eye drops. Stem cell therapy, in which human embryonic stem cell-derived RPE cells are transplanted subretinally in patients with severe advanced Stargardt disease. Gene therapy using lentivirus virus vector has also been tried. Another technique to improve the quality of life is using a biofeedback rehabilitation, in which with the help of microperimetry, a preferred retinal locus is selected, and the patient is asked to move the eyes according to the audio signals to make it as a trained retinal locus. ROSTAR studies comprise of retrospective and prospective longitudinal studies, in which there are 250 patients recruited from 9 centers across US and Europe. Till date, they have published 9 reports. Stargardt 3 and 4 is autosomal dominant. Stargardt 3 is caused by mutation in ELOVL4 gene, which is involved in the synthesis of fatty acid. The presentation is similar to that of autosomal recessive Stargardts, but often the flakes are bigger. In Stargardt 4 is caused by mutation in PROM1 gene, which presents as bullseye maculopathy. Moving on to North Carolina dystrophy, it is an autosomal dominant disease. It was first identified in a group of settlers in a mountainous region of the North Carolina. They generally present with diminution of vision in the first decade with bilateral symmetrical fundus appearance. There are 3 grades. In grade 1, there is diffuse Drusen-like deposits. In grade 2, this become confluent Drusens. And in grade 3, there is severe chorioretinal atrophy centrally surrounded by a thick fibrotic rim. Sorby pseudo-inflammatory macular dystrophy is autosomal dominant maculopathy, which is caused by a mutation in the gene involved in the tissue inhibitor of metalloproteinase. They generally present in third to fifth decade of life. Night blindness can be an early symptom, and they have loss of vision because of atrophy or because of CNVM development. They have confluent yellow Drusen-like deposit throughout the posterior pole, and in later stages, a CNVM develops. Autosomal dominant Drusen is caused by a mutation in fibulin 3 gene on chromosome 2. The presentation is generally in third to fifth decade of life with decreased vision and metamorphopsia. The classical findings include a large honeycomb-shaped Drusen occupying the posterior pole, as well as in some patients there is radial Drusen which are hyperfluorescent, and on OCT they are seen in the sub-RPE region. Martini's crinkled retinal pigment epithelopathy was first described in 2013 in three families who originated from Martinique, a West Indies island. The onset of age is generally at 30 years of age. It is caused by a missense mutation in MAGCAP3 gene, which is involved in the basement membrane modeling. On fundus examination, there is diffuse deep white lines seen in the macula giving a crinkled appearance. There are different stages described. The preclinical stage is the normal stage. In stage 1, there is dried out soil pattern. In stage 2, there is this pattern progresses to the peripheral retina. And in stage 3, it is associated with PCV formation. These are the complications in which there is a DC form scar formation and peripheral pigmentary changes. So to summarize, each dystrophy has a distinct clinical feature. There is no definitive treatment available, and patients should be counseled and reassured about the non-blending nature of the condition. Patients should be advised to be under regular follow-up for the development and treatment of any complications, and genetic counseling should be offered. Thank you.
I thought you were talking of the presentation.
No, no, no.
Okay, I think for the first question, probably for the benefit of the whole class, would be why is EOG preferentially affected in vitelliforms? I think a lot of you would want to know, and she has the answer for you.
Ma'am, generally, the EOG, we see light rise and dark trough. Light rise occurs because when light hits the photoreceptor cells, they attach to the apical layer of the RPE cells, resulting in secretion of a second messenger, which is thought to be calcium. And this calcium release is controlled by bestrophin gene. So when bestrophin gene is knocked out, the calcium release is not there, and hence the chloride conductance channel don't open. So there is no depolarization of the RPE cells, and hence there is no light peak. So the light to dark trough is decreased, resulting in low Arden's ratio.
So why is EOG so important in vitelliform disease and not in other diseases? What happens to EOG in RP?
Ma'am, in advanced cases, even in RP, we can have low Arden's ratio.
Most of the photoreceptor diseases also will have a EOG which is low. So what is important in EOG in vitelliform is that in presence of a normal ERG, you are having a subnormal EOG. Subnormal EOG will always go hand in hand with the subnormal ERG. There are only a couple of diseases where the EOG is reduced out of proportion to the ERG, and that is one is vitelliform and the other is? Anybody, one more? Other one is Azure. We don't see that very often, but in early cases where you have ERG which is normal, you can ask for an EOG. But if already ERG is abnormal, then there is not much of a use getting EOG done, because then you know that anyway EOG will be. So it won't be a differential. So in early stages of Azure, if you want to differentiate and you're having this diagnosis in mind, you can ask for an EOG. It will be subnormal in those cases also. So in the case, you can go back to your slides. In the case that you showed in ARB, the autosomal recessive Bester rhinopathy. That's a case which has been seen here, so probably all of you can see it's not a very common thing to see. In fact, I have also not seen a patient. I just asked her the MRD number, then I saw the case. It's been seen here in first in SNK, and then I think Chetan has seen the patient here. You have. Yeah, they say that the genetic diagnosis is a must because it is a very pleomorphic kind of a thing. So this is actually quite a typical case of autosomal recessive Bester rhinopathy, and the one of the most typical things which was there was that typical deposits of yellowish white deposits which are there, and the ERG which is normal, and the EOG is remarkably 1.2. I think even in Best disease itself, in the vitelliform disease, also you don't get a such a subnormal EOG. So EOG is usually 1.6, 1.5, or 1.4, but this is really down. And also, the patient had typically presentation with the angle closure glaucoma, right? So that is another thing which can be highlighted, though you did mention that even VMD has a high risk of angle closure, but I think it is the Bester rhinopathies which are more typically associated with the angle closure glaucoma. So if you have this combination of angle closure, and these patients have some amount of night vision problems also they could have. So these vitelliform-like deposits with some kind of night vision problems, angle closure is something which you need to remember in combination. Now that we are talking of vitelliform deposits, anything else which can cause a vitelliform deposit?
Multifocal CSR can present. It can be a one of the differential diagnoses. Then confluent drusen seen in late stages of AMD. Then exudative.
What is that called? Confluent drusen seen in late stages of AMD. These days they give a term to everything. That is called acquired vitelliform deposits in AMD. So that is another differential these days. Again, large. They are associated typically with large drusen, and you have these vitelliform deposits. One more thing which can have a similar picture. Anybody has seen patients with multiple myeloma? The multiple myeloma maculopathies also, they sometimes present with this picture of vitelliform kind of a lesion in the center, and it's very difficult to differentiate between Best disease until unless, of course, the patient comes with a history of multiple myeloma.
Kind of paraproteinemias can cause, and then there is autoimmune retinopathy. Can also
the light chain retinopathies.
Yeah. Mic. Yeah. In fact, most of these proteinopathies, multiple myeloma, Wegener's, this Waldenström macroglobulinemia and all, they in fact present in a manner similar to that fundus pulverulentus which has been published by Rupak. So you actually end up with a serous detachment at the macula, but that is that serous material is actually very high in proteins. So that leads to some localized RPE degeneration. And you see a pattern exactly the same that they have shown, which has this patchy like a leopard skin pattern you see at the macula. And if you do OCT, then you will see macular detachment with some some material under the macula. And this can be seen long after the disease is quiet. Regarding this EOG, abnormal EOG, what I remember long back from my PG days, apart from the two disease entities which you have mentioned, there are four more entities in which EOG is abnormal. Anybody knows?
Ma'am, late stages of Stargardt's can have abnormal EOG. Then chloroquine toxicity can sometimes have low Arden's ratio. Pattern dystrophy can present with subnormal EOG.
Yes, butterfly dystrophy, which you mentioned, can have low ERG, abnormal ERG. What else? Pontus flavimacularis also can have. Anyway, go and read Basic Sciences, AO, the electrophysiology chapter. It gives the answer.
Ma'am, why don't you talk about that Stargardt's paper also at the same time, the OCT in Stargardt's?
So this the study which we did, OCT, that was the SS-OCT, because we wanted to see the deeper structure, the choroid. So basically, if you look at the atrophy which occurs in Stargardt versus the atrophy which occurs in AMD, so both present with macular atrophy, but the atrophy is different in Stargardt's than in AMD. I mean, not in appearance-wise, but in histopathological-wise. So if you see in Stargardt, you will see more of a... although the choroid is not... the choroid is... the thickness of the choroid may be same, but if you see degeneration of small capillaries, small choroidal levels, vessels. So small choroidal vessels are atrophied, but the large choroidal vessels remain the same, and in fact there is a compensatory dilatation of the large choroidal vessels. So as a result, you may, in the initial stages at least, you may see that the choroid thickness remains the same, but as the age increases, this Stargardt, the atrophy at the macula increases, and the vision also reduces. And in those in advanced cases, you can see that there is a choroidal atrophy as well.
Similar paper, but a different approach with ICG, was published by Storenghi group, in which they studied the same question on how advanced AMD is different from Stargardt's, using ICG. Dark atrophy, right.
What is the first sign on OCT in Stargardt's?
There is thickening of the external limiting membrane.
Even before the atrophy has set in, the first thing that you should look for is the thickening of ELM. What causes the wear off membrane and the sign?
Ma'am, it is a thickening of the interdigitation layer, in which in the early stages, when there is the RP cells are functioning more than the normal physiological conditions, then there is deposition occurring, which results in the interdigitation zone hypertrophy.
Those deposits that you get below the neurosensory retina, what are they actually supposed to represent?
Photoreceptor outer.
Answer. Yeah, Amit, you are photoreceptors.
Outer cell.
Elongated photoreceptors, and that is seen because the RP phagocytosis is reduced, so there is increased presence of these photoreceptors. What is the difference between FAF and NIR? You spoke of,
yes, ma'am,
under autofluorescence, and you spoke of near infrared reflectance.
Ma'am, general FAF, in which we use a blue wavelength, it is, the wavelengths are similar to that of fluorescent angiogram. And in near infrared, we use a near infrared wavelength. And in this, the near infrared wavelength, they generally measure the melanin content of the RP. So the near infrared, the fovea will be hyper autofluorescent, whereas in FAF, the fovea will be hypo autofluorescent in normal conditions. So in near infrared, we measure the hyper autofluorescent, hypofluorescent, which occurs. Whereas in FAF, they are both inverse. Like if hyper autofluorescence on FAF increases, there will be decrease in the NIA fluorescence.
This you spoke of NIA, NIA.
Yes, ma'am.
What is NIR?
Ma'am, near infrared reflectance, in which a near infrared wavelength is used, but there is no barrier used. So the light goes and that same light is reflected back.
It comes there back from barrier. Where?
Ma'am, from the RPE.
What pigment are you seeing in NIR and what pigment are you looking at in FAF?
Ma'am, in FAF we see lipofuscin.
Very good. And then in NIR?
NIR we...
What of whispering is happening loudly? Tell what you're seeing. Melanin. And lutein. So what is the implication? Use a mic, something.
Lutein pigment. And so we cannot really study the RP at the fovea in a short wave or FAF.
If you want to differentiate on an FAF, whether the hypoautofluorescence is because of loss of lipofuscin or is it because of the lutein in the fovea which is blocking it, you
then
have to use NIR.
Yes.
You can't make it out from FAF. What is early onset Stargardt's and what is late onset Stargardt's? You did make a mention to this, but just to emphasize it, I'm sure half the people would have not registered it.
Ma'am, early onset Stargardt generally occurs in the early teens. The patient generally have a fovea involving atrophy, and the prognosis of this patient, they have severe visual impairment and the prognosis is poorer. Whereas in late onset Stargardt's, they generally involve the peripheral. There are flakes deposit, but the foveal cones are spared. So they generally preserve the visual acuity for a longer period of time as compared to early onset Stargardt's.
Is it same as EORD, ma'am?
Until unless you do a genetic testing and then decide whether it is same or not.
Early onset or retinal degeneration is something.
No, it is ABCA4 which is causing, but it is not causing a drop in ERG to begin with. So early onset RP will be different from early onset Stargardt's. Early onset Stargardt's, we are looking at as early as 7, but early onset RP will have a flat ERG by 7 years. Whereas early onset Stargardt's, we are looking at something like an, it may start like an occult macular dystrophy. You may not even have flex, and to begin with, the patient will just have a foveal atrophy. But again, these diagnoses are largely made because they have ABCA4 and showing the typical mutations at the level.